welcome. Glad to be with you again on this first Sunday in November, November 1st, 2020, as you come and worship with us here at West Guilford Baptist Church. Pray that the Lord has encouraged you this week and given you a week full of blessings and encouragement in every way. Today is halfway through our campaign with our Samaritan's Purses Christmas boxes, and we're collecting boxes of toys and small pieces of clothing, socks, and different things that we send off to Samaritan's Purse, and they distribute these boxes in third world countries to children who otherwise will not have anything this Christmas. And not only does it encourage their heart and brings a smile and joy to their heart that they have something just for them, but it can do much more than that. As a matter of fact, it has done much more than that, in that it has reached children for Jesus Christ, having made commitments to Christ, and even beyond that, drawing them to ministry so they can minister to the Lord full time. We're going to watch one of those stories today on video. We're going to watch it right now. God is indeed good, and through Jesus he changes hearts and lives and gives opportunities that we never otherwise would have. Let's praise him through song right now as we worship the Lord through singing and praise song.
To your side, and I they pierced his side. For me he opened that fountain, that crimson cleansing tide. For me he's waiting in glory upon his heavenly throne. He promised never to leave me, no, never to leave me alone. No, never alone, no, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone.
Mother Teresa once said, "The most terrible poverty in the world is loneliness and the feeling of being unloved and unheard." She might be right. Today, I want to begin a new series from Max Lucado's new book entitled, "You Are Never Alone." The feeling of being alone is overwhelming to many people, and during this time that we're going through, this COVID-19 time, many people feel that way. They feel unloved. Many feel they have no one to talk to, no one to confide in. And that can create a heavy sadness in a person's heart. It can even lead to depression or to despair, a feeling of hopelessness. What's the use? Why keep going on? Why not just end it? Terrible feeling. Max Lucado writes, "When you are in this downward spiral, you can easily convince yourself that no one cares. No one can help you. No one can even hear you. And if they could, they wouldn't, because they really won't heed the call." It's easy to get in that state of mind. And the fear is for the outcome of this COVID-19 will be much more than the numbers who got the disease, got the virus, even those who died of the virus, that many, many people may enter into a place where they feel totally alone. Over the next 6 or 7 weeks, I want us to look at some themes from Max Lucado's book that is based on encounters that people had with Jesus in the book of John. Encounters that left them with hope, knowing that this Jesus cared for them, and that God cared for them, and God was there, and God would never leave them alone. In North America, that Max Lucado is a best-selling author. Some of you may know him, may have read many of his books. He's written over 100 books. But for some of you may say, "I've never heard of the guy." Well, he has 140 million books in print. Yet he intimately knows the subject that he is writing about for this particular book. For Max Lucado shares, not just here but in other places, that he has been in the pit of loneliness before. He's been in the seat of those who feel depressed and alone. He's even fought the demons of alcohol addiction at one time in his life. And yet he writes this book because he has found that God has been faithful and has shown himself to be present and to be powerful in his life, even in those really hard times. So he knows what he is speaking about and what he is writing about. In this book, You Were Never Alone, Lucado looks at these encounters that Jesus had with people, and he then brings it into the light of our circumstances. And I pray that the Lord will take his writings and my application and whatever way he wants to meld them together, and will encourage you to keep looking up to the God who created you, the God who molds you, the God who cares for you, the God who loved you so much that he sent his son Jesus to this earth to show you that love. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world, so loved the people of the world, that he sent his only forever Son, Jesus, that whosoever believes and trusts in him will not perish, will not be separated from him for eternity, but will find that they can know him in an intimate way. That when we put our trust in him, Jesus, he is always there for us from that day forward, whether we feel his presence or not. A catchphrase quote that you will hear throughout this series is this: you are stronger than you think because Jesus is nearer than you know or feel. You are stronger than you think because Jesus is nearer than you know or feel. We can't rely upon our feelings when we're down in the dumps. We need to rely upon the Word of God and the presence of God through His Word and through His Spirit that lives within us. This quote is based on Jesus' promise in Hebrews 12:5. It says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And His final promise to His disciples in Matthew 28:20. He said, I am with you always to the very end of this age until he returns again, and then we will be with him. We will see him face to face. Certainly this includes to the end of our age on this earth. He has promised, I will be with you till I take you from this world, and then you will be with me, present with me, to be absent from the body, the Word of God said, means to be present with the Lord, with the living Lord, with the Creator God who created you and me. What a wonderful promise. And through the next 6 or 7 weeks, I want us to draw close into His presence, into His promises, and experience the oneness of knowing that we are one with Him. He lives within us, and we live within him, and know that he will never leave us nor forsake us. You are never alone. This morning I want us to begin this series with Jesus' first miracle. It's rather a mundane one in some ways, and it's found in John 2:1-11. Not mundane in that it's a miracle, and we will see that only God could perform, and he did through Jesus, his Son. But it comes in a kind of a mundane setting for a miracle. And it's a miracle that doesn't change a person's life necessarily, but shows that Jesus is always open to our requests, to those things that are important in our heart. I'm calling it, God is with you in the ordinary. In the ordinary events of each and every day. So let's look at John chapter 2, as it's found in John 2. Jesus changes water into wine, verse 1. Now on the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no more wine. Dear woman, why do you involve me? Jesus replied, my time has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet. They did so. And the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now. This, the first of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed at Cana in Galilee. He thus revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. Wow, perhaps the last part of that is something that I need to comment on at the beginning. This was his first miracle. He had just called his disciples to come follow him. They had come, some of them being drawn by the Spirit, but not knowing why. And yet here they saw him turn water into wine, and it says that his disciples put their faith in him. For the disciples, this was a life-changing moment. Want to maybe encourage you to look at that and see that. This miracle at a common wedding was something that was not very common in miracles happening. Weddings in Jesus' day, in B.C. 30 or so, were very special events. They still are now, except maybe in 2020, where there aren't many weddings going on. But for many people, there are still special half days or perhaps full day events. I've done many weddings. I've done them in churches. I've done them in courtyards. Done them in people's cottages, in their backyards. Done it on decks. Done weddings in many different settings, and they're very meaningful and very special if they're done with an attitude of reverence to God. But I've never done a wedding like this wedding. For in Jesus' days, weddings often lasted up to a week in length. Think about that. People would come, and they'd come with their bedding and with their tents, planning to stay for a grand event, for the wedding feast and days and celebration that took anywhere from 3 to 7 days, often a full week. Weddings like that were not just one meal, there were many meals, and not just a couple of toasts of wine. Many people drank wine for all 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days. So you would need to have a lot of wine on hand. And it was the responsibility of the couple getting married to make sure there was enough wine. And so in a feasting type event like that, where there's lots of feasting and toasting and drinking and throwing down wine glasses, it was a very celebrative time. And Jesus was there. He must have known those who were being married well. Some commentators believe perhaps it was the sister or brother of Mary herself that was getting married, a younger sister or brother. There's no proof of that, but it was someone who Mary knew, and Mary had been invited, and Jesus knew, and he had been invited, as well as his disciples. So it was probably a good size wedding as well. For another 6 to 12 people, didn't make much of a difference. Jesus was there, but there's no indication that he was there as anything but another guest. He wasn't there as the rabbi who was officiating at the wedding. He was there in public as just an ordinary guest, like all the others. John indicates that on the third day of celebration, that's really the way it should be translated, that on the third day of the wedding, that's the proper translation. It was the third day of this wedding. How long it was going on, we don't know, but it was the third day that Jesus' mother, Mary, discovers that all the wine was gone. How she discovered, we don't know. But immediately she thinks of Jesus. And she goes to Jesus because she can't go to the LCBO. There was no town LCBO. People had to make wine the old-fashioned way. And there was no way they were going to be able to do that. But she knew that her Jesus had the power, if he willed, to get them more wine. Of course she knew. She was the one the angel came to and told her, you were going to give birth to a child. You're going to name him Jesus. But I'm a virgin. Doesn't matter. God himself has put the seed in you. She was the one who had heard the angel said, and he will be the Son of God. And she had seen the way he had grown up, sinless. She had obviously observed him very closely. And at this wedding, she felt compelled to go to him and tell him, we're out of wine. And Jesus told her, woman, Mary, this isn't my time yet. It's not the public time that the Father and I have decided to start my public ministry. What do you want me to do? I love her response. For her response was totally the response of a woman whose faith was in Jesus. A woman who knew that whatever he decided to do, it was okay. Her response was, whatever he tells you to do, do it. She spoke to the servants. She said, whatever he decides to do, do it. Just do what he says. And she walked away. There doesn't seem to be any indication that she was upset. It was a pure faith response. She didn't get mad. She didn't go stomping off. She could have said, all these years I've been doing your laundry, making your bed, cooking your meals, all these years, and this is the kind of response you give me? No indication of that. Instead, do whatever he tells you to do. Wow, there's something we can learn in that. You see, Mary knew that Jesus could do something, that he could do anything. So she brought the situation to him, but then she left the result of her request in his hands. She knew that he hadn't come to earth to be a wine provider for this wedding. That wasn't his main purpose in coming. She knew that. But it was on her heart. It was a concern. She didn't want to see the embarrassment of this couple that she obviously loved and cared for. It wouldn't have been the end of the world embarrassment, but it was something she cared about. So she brought it to the one who she knew had the ability to do something about it. Now, Jesus wasn't rebuking Mary when he told her, why do you bring it to me? He was stating a fact. This is not the time the Father in heaven and I have decided. But obviously, he heard her words. He saw her love and concern for this couple. And it changed his plan somewhat. We don't know why. Maybe he knew she was going to ask and that was in the plan. But though his word said one thing, he obviously contemplated it and then decided that he would do something. Jesus, because he loved and cared for his mother Mary, decided to get involved. And this is so important for us to hear, because many times we think that Jesus and God the Father aren't interested in our day-to-day ordinary situations. That we can bring the big requests to him, diseases that no one can heal but God. We can bring bankruptcy to him because he has promised to provide for our needs. But to bring the fact that we're feeling a little down, or that we're feeling sad today, or we're still experiencing big pangs of grief because we've lost loved ones, I can't keep bringing those things to him. How can I? He has bigger things to be concerned about. Oh, I got a headache. I had one this week, a migraine. Oh, initially, what did I do? I went and got some medication, took the medication, put my head down, couldn't see very good, and needed to try to fall asleep, and it wasn't going, and it hit me. I haven't even talked to Jesus about it. He cares. He loves me. While I was talking to him about it, by the grace of God, I fell asleep. When I woke up 2 hours later, again, the grace of God, the headache was away, gone. It's not always that way. Sometimes the headache is still there. God's plans are not always our plans, but they're good plans. So we can bring headaches or backaches or knees or hips or arthritis in our hands. Those of you who are older listening to this message, you know all of those things. Imagine the most of you are shaking your heads. You know about those things. Tummy aches, flus, certainly things like possibility of COVID, if we have some of those symptoms. We can bring all of those things to the Lord because He cares for us. He cares for us when we are feeling lonely, when we are feeling stressed out, when we feel we can't take any more. He cares and He wants to help us. Sometimes the way He helps us is He puts something else on our mind to do for someone else. I've experienced that so many times. When I brought something to Him and laid it at His foot, then He'll show me the next thing He wants me to do. And as I do that thing out of obedience, it takes my mind and my focus off of that ordinary but important thing that I brought to Him. Jesus is concerned for the ordinary. He wants to help us with our budgeting. He wants to help us to help others. He wants to help us when we feel hopeless or discouraged. He wants us to know we can bring everything to Him and then leave it at His feet. That's the key. We need to leave it at His feet. That's what Mary did. She said, now do whatever He tells you to do. He might have said to them, well, just serve Him some water now, and not done any miracle. It seems that Mary was content to leave it in Jesus' hands. That's what the Word of God is for us. We need to know what the Word of God says so that we can be content. We can find peace with whatever way He answers our prayers. In Philippians 4, verse 6 and 7, it says, do not be anxious about anything, but with a thankful, trusting heart, bring your requests to God, and He will give you a peace that passes all understanding, and it will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. When you are in Christ Jesus, when you put your trust in Jesus Christ, you can bring Him any request, and you can leave it with Him, and He will give you the gift of peace and a calmness in your heart. In this particular wedding scenario, Jesus decided to miraculously answer Mary's request for more wine by turning ordinary water into wine. And not just any kind of wine, not a cooking wine. It was the best wine available. Matter of fact, the steward was so concerned, saying, usually you serve the best first, but you saved it till now. Wow, what a surprise that is. But bring it out. And they brought it out. You know, we too can expect God's answer to our prayers. He always hears and always answers our prayers. But the answers are not always what we want. Because sometimes He says, that is a good prayer, and I'm going to answer it in my time, but the time isn't right. So He says, not now. Now, I haven't met too many people who say, oh, I love that answer. Not now. For most of us, we want Him to answer the prayer before we even pray it. But the answer to many prayers is not now. This is not the right time. Sometimes the answer is no. I know what's best for you, and the answer of this prayer is not. I think of the Apostle Paul, who had some sort of thorn in the flesh, some sort of ailment, most scholars believe, physical ailment, and he brought it to the Father, he brought it to Jesus three times, and finally the impression God put on his heart, or maybe in his ears, is, my grace is sufficient. I'm not going to answer this prayer the way you want, but I will give you grace, and I will give you more grace, and I will help you, and I will use even this ailment for my glory, and you will know I'm using it for my glory. And eventually, in many cases, people accept that ailment and accept the fact that that's the way God allowed things to work out. Many of you know the story of Johnny Erickson, the woman who broke her neck when diving into the water as a teenager, became totally paralyzed from the head down. She prayed and begged God to heal her. When it became evident that God wasn't going to do that, she finally started looking that, well then, how can I live this life, the rest of my life, in a way that I will get me through, that I won't always be depressed? And he started showing her opportunities, gave her the opportunity to sing and record music, wrote a book, starred in a movie about her life. She played the starring role, gave her a ministry to other people who had similar injuries and similar situations. She's over 70 years of age now. She got married and has been married 30 years. When asked, Johnny, if you could wave a magic wand and change things so that it went back to the way you were before, would you do that? And she said, and miss out on the adventure God has given me? No way. I could never have had this joyful of a life, this full of a life, if this hadn't happened. I'm going to walk again, and I'm going to dance again. But it's going to be in heaven, and it's going to be for eternity. Now I am content. I am at peace. God wants you and I to be content and at peace, even in those times when we feel all alone, even in those times when we feel overwhelmed with stress, or we feel, I just can't go on in this direction without God helping me by answering this particular part of the prayer. Don't put God in a box, because your boxes are way too small. He wants to bless and use our lives much broader than whatever we could hope or imagine. We need to put it in His hands and then take our hands off and back off and say, Your will be done. Your perfect will be done. I trust you. The way He answers our prayer may not be miraculous like it was here. It may be a slow answer. It may be something that every day we need to keep bringing it to Him. But He has promised, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And I want to remind you what we started with. We need to remember that He wants us to know that we are stronger than we think, because Jesus Jesus is closer than we know and closer than we feel. We can't just go by our feelings. We have to go by the promise of His word. Sometimes He'll answer them right away. Other times, in the ordinary situations, He will say, walk with me. And as we walk with Him, we will experience Him. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank You for this great story of Jesus' first miracle. It was at an ordinary wedding for that day event. It was not something that changed the couple's life. It got them out of a bit of a pickle. It was miraculous indeed, but it was during the ordinary time of a wedding. And yet behind the scenes, the disciples saw all of this. And perhaps big picture, that's why You allowed it, was You wanted Your disciples to see the power You had, Jesus. And it says that they believed. That they believed in You, in Your power, in who You were. Help us, Father, in the ordinariness of life, to bring the small things and the big things to You, and help us to be satisfied with whatever answer You give us. Not now, no, or yes, this is in My will. You are a good God, and we thank You. I pray Your encouragement will go forth for each person who hears this message, for those who perhaps have never put their trust in You. They don't know how near You are because they've never asked You to be part of their life, to forgive them of their sins. If they are hearing this right now and their heart is pounding, Lord Jesus, I pray that You will speak to their heart and say, come to me, put your trust, lay your burden down, ask me for forgiveness, mean it, be sincere, and I will forgive you of your sins, and I will come and live with you, and you will, I will be with you, whether you sense it or not. On those days that you don't, I still will be there. Oh, Father, speak to each of us wherever we're at. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Hope you have a wonderful day.